distinguished ladies and gentlemen, the organizers of this program, my good friend Shola, Demola, Bryce, and several others, the team, our own Diolu. I have 18 minutes to speak briefly on why becoming an activist is inevitable. Well, I started off wanting to be a nun, and then I needed to find my purpose. So wanting to be a nun after my secondary education, I got to the University of Ilorin, although my father had said he was going to disown me, but I didn't feel bad because his dear father carried to me, he was just my happy father. But when he said we break my mutual, I was too young then. I continued with my education. So from my A levels, I got to the University of Ilorin. Still getting to the University of Ilorin, I needed to find my purpose, and I still wanted to be a nun. One day, one of the lecturers discovered me because she said somebody scored 95% in her test. And she's a very sweet lecturer that each time we are writing our test, one will have to keep very steady men. So my friend called the body and said, Reverend Sister, did you stretch your neck? I said, no. So at the end, I went to her office and then she asked me why I was looking for her. I started stammering. She said, I just stammered. I said, oh. She said, be confident. What happened? I told her, she said, I scored the highest in her course. And that was how. She said, why are you called Reverend Sister? I said, I want to be a mom. And at the end, she gave me books to read. She showed me the shelf and I saw a lot of books. So she gave me one to read. And then I found a quotation by Madam Taki. No. Our lives begin to end the day we keep silent about things that matter. So that was how I started. From University of Ilorin, military room was an aberration. So I became the coordinator of women in Nigeria from that place to Committee for Defense of Human Rights in 1989 and later on campaign for democracy. And then I wrote my purpose there that I want to be a change agent, and that I was not interested in the status quo. And you know that the status quo at times gets boring if one is not desirous of effecting a change. And that was how we started. We had several campaigns against military dictatorship. And each time there was any campaign, I would prefer to be at the forefront. I would prefer to confront camps. And then we felt there was something extraordinary. So that each time I was even incarcerated, they would ask me, do I want to drink, do I want to smoke? How do they want to get me tough? But forgetting the fact that it's what I believe in that keeps me very strong. And then I continued. So one day in the office there, I received a phone call from Dr. Bekorasan that said she saw one of my flyers, and that was how he called me and proceeded to Lagos. Getting to Lagos, my appointment was for 4. I got there 4:30. He was on his way out to seek and find me. So he then called Chief. Chief said, okay, I'll come along. And that was how I went with him to Chief Chambers, getting to Chief, seeing and Chief can find me, members of the team. Their simplicity, their disciplinary life, the way their office is arranged, everything endeared them to me. So that was how, after seeing Gary, Bekor said he wanted to see Fela, and I followed him to see Fela. Although Fela asked me, what is your name? I said, my name is Andrew. He said, what is your name? Go. I said, okay, I didn't go to the meeting, and I told him. At the end, the few things inspired me. Fela was a part, but all the things he discussed with me ended up inspiring me. And that was how I started making a series of protests against the dictatorship. There was a time I was shot on my neck, several others, and you can see working with the team, then moving, wanting a change in Nigeria that works, all remember one day when we woke up, we had Iken and this sensitive gift that was given to us. So after discovering my purpose, ensuring that the status quo does not remain, I still continue. And then I realized everywhere that everyone wishes that justice should be done, but only few want to see it. So I decided to stand out, and by standing out, I also decided to work for it. And in working for it, I always get people organized and were sure that and those are a series of protests I've been involved in Chibu, where some women were surprised. They pierced pepper and bottle inside them because they said they stole 50 naira pepper. And then several other things. In terms of violence against women, anytime anything happens, I will move out and I will ensure that those people get justice. And in standing out, I just felt that sense of fulfillment. And even a few days back, I think on the 16th of September, we had the case of a tricycle that the police wanted 2,000 and then they shot him. But the police pierced the wife. Came out and then beat him on the hand and then the jaw. So yesterday or day before yesterday, we went to celebrate the son's birthday. So after finding my purpose and then standing out, I just also felt that there was a need for one to keep galvanizing the more so that you get more people involved, more people are convinced. And you know, one thing I realize is that those that lose their soul will find it. And if you stake everything, believing that one, whatever one is convinced is working well. So when I'm convinced about something, I move out, irrespective of the forces that want to stop me, I will ensure that I move and whatever I want to do, I do it as fast as possible. Because I realize that even during the time I was incarcerated, when I was shot on my bed, I didn't feel that I had to protect my own life. But unfortunately, those who were running, who were hiding, were those beat by the bullets. And so, Garifa and me will always tell us, stand up for what is right, even if you are standing alone. So wherever we find ourselves, and also bearing ourselves in the sound of the collective, is also a very, very important and crucial thing. So wherever I find myself, I will stand out. During military dictatorship, going to face posters, I will go to the other barracks and place mine. And then the last one is that in the end, everyone will die, but only few will live forever in the minds of the people. Of tea, this is forever. He believes in very oneself in the sound of the collective. Garifa and me, who has always believed in collective efforts. It lives on, Fela lives on, Matutaki lives on. Karl Marx, that said, because of us have interpreted the world, the problem is changing. It lives on, our fight that believes that what we do for ourselves dies because the hope for the others and the world remains. It lives on, Abraham Lincoln, that believes that the worthiness of life is in the service of mankind. If one dies to lose it, it becomes a matter. It lives on. So, it's not really the number of houses that we have or the cars that we ride, but how we've been able to affect lives from generation to generation. How we've been able to impact lives to turn into Elijah. The mother was shot, she was killed. October 1, I went there for his birthday. That's why the father and the mom was calling him. Well, as far as Kutnogu, during the purpose of the day, and in going to Kutnogu, realizing that one of the girls that was mine, that the girl died, went there, set aside, buried aside, and met a lot of persons. So, in summary, before I want to listen to a short clip, we traveled to Asaba, and I didn't know that my team got clips of something that happened. But, so, in summing up, or let me wait for my team to think what's purpose. And then the person who serves helps to impact lives, either consciously or unconsciously. And after impacting lives, you also find out, like you said, why he was speaking with you, that what he believes in is not only scoring 90%, but our other students scored such because they believe in what is doing or because he has inspired them. So I want to encourage all of us. Just like I told you, I never believed I would be where I found myself today. I never believed that the State Department would invite me to join other presidents, Ghanaian, Tanzanian president, and the U.S. Secretary of State for a debate in Washington, D.C. I never believed that a Michelle Obama would be by my side to tell me, Joe, I appreciate what you are doing. So in engaging in all that, let us try as much as possible to put in our best in whatever we do. When one is committed and when one is determined, where determination exists, failure can ever dismantle the flag of success. Like I told you that while growing up, my life changed through some of the books that I read. And I told you about Reverend Martin Luther King. We also know about Rosa Parks, the woman who refused to get up from the bus. And since that time, a lot of other people emulated what she has done. So the thing is that when I don't strive as much as possible to be a coalition maker, it's my very close friend. I don't do what I think I should do. I don't strive hard to be a fellow, to put on pants and walking around the streets. But some of the things that he has gone a long way in inspiring me. For many songs, I listen to read. After for many says, this the what I've won all my time, this type of hair. Just to eat, remembering his feelings, and also knowing that he lives forever. And I just want us to realize that the worthiness of life is deep-rooted in the service of mankind. If one dies in the process, it becomes a matter. And Transparence says that everyone who can is either a coward or a traitor. We can never be cowards, neither can be traitors. As we have come today, I don't really want us to fold our arms at people and continue to agonize. Agonizing will not get us anywhere. We must organize. Wherever we find ourselves, is it in the hostel, is it at the marketplace, you are a market woman selling yams and you use clay to pack up the bad yams that you have. You are a student in the hostel and yours is courtesy, yours is cheating. Let us remember, in those days, even in Hampus up to now, that a good play is 1 million times better than the riches that any of us can buy. Finally, during the slavery era, a Guyanese planter and his friend exchanged correspondence. And his friend said, how do you keep all these slaves together? He said, we simply keep them divided. The more united we are as a nation, the more assertive we are as youths of this country. Because the youths are not the leaders of tomorrow, they are the leaders of today, and they are the lubricants for the survival of this great entity called Nigeria. There is a need for us to change our mindset. The mindset that says Yahoo Yahoo is the one that will pay us. The mindset that says Aristo is the one that will pay us. But I want us to have a change of mindset. That mindset that insists on excellence, working and doing something to earn a living is what to strive hard to work towards. And I just want us to realize that while listening to me, someone might be inspired. All fingers are not equal. It's extremely impossible for me to clap with one hand, but to get a resounding applause, I have to clap with both hands. So there is a need for us. Let's just not keep complaining. We know that when we strive hard, when we contribute meaningfully to the growth and development of a great country called Nigeria, there will be a change. Let us also realize that injustice to one is injustice to all. Injustice anywhere is injustice everywhere. So when things happen, don't look the other way. There are ways in which you can help to put smile on the faces of the great citizens of this country. And I just want us to also realize that if we decide to sit in our own environment without moving out, without realizing that making meaningful impact has to be the collective responsibility of everyone, then just pull out our people or just stay and continue to agonize and agonize. You also, as you listen to me here, you can find your purpose. It's not too late for anyone to find his own purpose. You will know where you have found your purpose that you have the passion, you have the strong will, and if you move, if you strive hard, I'm sure that you will succeed. And when you find your purpose, you take that step forward to actualize your purpose. And in actualizing your purpose, it might be different from the person that is sitting beside you, or that is sitting at your front or your back. And I'm sure that when you do realize that, you will believe that anything that you do, don't think that you want to save your life, you want to preserve your life. God Almighty is the only one who can give and take life. And I'm also sure that with a little smile, you also help to encourage somebody. Probably somebody that wants to commit suicide, somebody who wants to commit abortion, somebody who is in rape. But you touching lives one way or the other, you will help in encouraging such a person, and the humanity of such a person will be put there. I really want to thank the organizers of this program, and I want to salute anyone that has made that time to be here. And I want to say that your coming here will never be in vain. And I'm also sure that each and everyone that has listened to me today will be inspired. Thank you.